الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد الأمي وآله وصحبه. أما بعد، my dear brothers and sisters, my dear children, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Tomorrow, inshallah, the world will be celebrating the International Women's Day. And as you know, Islam condemns all forms of violence against women. Islam gave women rights, which women in the West are still struggling to achieve them. So we must all take action to end violence against women and girls. And let me mention something about violence against women. How does Islam deal with it? Today people are blaming Islam for domestic violence, for forced marriages, for FGM, for honor killing. But Islam is innocent from any of these crimes. It is us who are to be blamed, the Muslims, not Islam. There's a big difference between Islam as a religion and we as Muslims, the way we conduct ourselves. Unfortunately, we give the wrong message, or we send the wrong message to non-Muslims about Islam. There was a Hindu, very famous Hindu actress, actually, a few years ago. She embraced Islam. And she said, shame on you Muslims. She was talking to the Muslims in India. You never told anybody that Islam gave such rights to women. And she embraced Islam because she felt that Islam gave women so many rights which they were denied in a country like India, maybe, or even in some Western countries today. So let me start. Professor Asallam was born into a community in which men's primary concern was their honor and women were associated with shame. Women were generally dehumanized and treated as commodities to be inherited or given in marriage to whomsoever her male guardian chose. The suffering of women was not only in Arabia, but it was experienced in many parts of the world. The Prophet ﷺ, starting with his own community and through divine revelation, brought revolution to the world, restoring dignity and humanity to its women folk, and radically changing the way in which believing men treated their women. How was this revolution brought about? How can the Prophet's example help us correct the behaviors of some Muslim communities in the UK who have adopted the customs of the time of ignorance? As if the Prophet had never came to the people with his message from God? A few years ago, the Metropolitan Police issued a very interesting document. And they had a strategy of the Mayor of London and the Metropolitan Police to take action to end the violence against women and girls. And let me read the aims of the document which they published. It aims to bring prevention to the heart of all initiatives to combat violence against women and girls and focus on rape, sexual assault, sexual exploitation, trafficking, forced marriage, female genital mutilation, FGM, domestic violence, economic deprivation, and violence committed in the name of honor. These crimes are not only committed by Muslims, they are committed by non-Muslims as well. But the only difference that we have in our teachings, in the divine revelation we received in the tradition of the Prophet ﷺ, we have guidance to avoid completely any of these crimes. This is the initiative which the Prophet ﷺ actively supported for all his life. Now, let me mention some of the rights of women in Islam. Some, not all of them. Prophet ﷺ said, "An-nisa'u shaqa'iqu rijal." Prophet said, women are the sisters of men, reported by Ahmad, Abu Dawood, and Tirmidhi. Very interesting. So before God, we are all equal. And as you know, the most honored of us in the sight of God is the righteous. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. The most honored of you in the sight of God is the righteous. Not the men, not the women, not the black, not the white, not the rich, not the poor. Nothing to do with that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter 33, very interesting. A woman went to the Prophet and said, oh Prophet of Allah, why Allah keeps mentioning men in the Quran? He doesn't talk about women. And this revelation came, verse 35, chapter 33. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات أعد الله لهم مغفرة وأجر عظيم. Now what is the difference between مسلمين and مسلمات؟ Male and female. The ta at the end of the word is known as ta التأنيث. When you put ta at the end of the word, it becomes feminine. So Allah is talking about Muslim men and Muslim women. Believing men and believing women. Devout men and devout women. True men and true women. Men and women who are patient and constant. Men and women who humble themselves. Men and women who give in charity. Men and women who fast. Men and women who guard their chastity. Men and women who engage much in Allah's remembrance. What are they going to get? Allah has prepared for them forgiveness and great reward. أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. So there's no difference. Another interesting point when we talk about the difference between the sexes. We have equal rights, but we have different responsibilities. A woman will have to carry a baby and breastfeed the baby. Something the man cannot do. This is her responsibility, and I have different responsibilities. It doesn't make them inferior. It doesn't make them less than men. Think about your mother and what she had to go through to bring you up. Think about your wife and what she does on a daily basis to support the family and look after the family. We have different responsibilities, but we have equal rights. People don't realize this. The liberation of women started over 1400 years ago following the revelation of the final and last divine revelation, the Holy Quran. During the 23 years of mission of the Prophet ﷺ and the following years of the four Muslim rulers, women enjoyed their rights. Later, when spiritual values were lost and people became dogmatic and manipulated the interpretation of the religion, they reverted to old traditions and women started to suffer again. So let me mention some of these rights. Now, I'll go through the rights, some of them, and then I will explain one or two in details, and then next Friday, inshallah, we may continue. The right to live with dignity in a safe, non-hostile environment. The right to seek knowledge and education. The right to work, as long as it's a lawful work. Whatever she earns is her own property. It does not belong to her husband or her father or her guardian. The right to ownership of assets in any form. The right to inherit. The right to choose her future husband and the right to receive a dowry from him. The right to keep her maiden name after marriage. The right to include certain conditions in the marriage contract. The right to divorce her husband under certain conditions. This divorce is known in Arabic as khula. Women have equality with men regarding forms of worship, reward, and punishment. So both sexes have spiritual as well as human rights and duties in an equal degree and the future reward of the hereafter. Women are accountable. Women are accountable and responsible for themselves, their families, and the society they live in. Islam respects the opinion of women and highly recommends that they should be consulted and invited to participate in the decision-making process, whether at home or at the community level or national or international. And I'm going to tell you a very interesting story here regarding consultation. You think Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who received divine revelation, would need to go and consult with one of his wives? What do you think? But he always, what happened? Can someone remind me when he went for Umrah and he was denied the access to Mecca? What happened when he signed a deal? What happened?
Almost
exactly. What happened exactly? That he asked the people to come out of a state of ihram, and the people refused. They refused. He said, no, we're not. So he went into his tent, and that was Umm Salama, and he said to her, halaka qawmi, my people will perish because they refused to obey me. They disobeyed me. She said, oh, Prophet of Allah, why don't you go out and ask the barber to come to shave you, and you go and slaughter your head, and they will follow you. That's exactly what he did, alayhi salatu wasalam. He went out, and the people rushed and pushed each other to do the same. So yes, we must learn to consult with women. Some people say, the Quran dehumanizes women because it regards the testimony. In Surah Al-Baqarah, at the end of Surah Al-Baqarah, there is the longest verse regarding debt, regarding borrowing money. And Allah says, whenever you have a transaction like this, you need to have two male witnesses. And if not available, then two women and one man, which means the testimony of a woman is equivalent to the testimony of one man. So women actually are less important. So can you imagine my daughter, who's a professor and PhD in one of the universities in America, and my wife, who's a consultant, Anissa at Whips Across, their testimony is equal to a man who can neither read nor write. Can you imagine what religion is this? Of course not. It's not the meaning. You see, the problem is the interpretation. The problem is the interpretation. How do we interpret such a thing? So, maybe another time. Or when the Quran says, وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً, men have a step higher than the women. Where? When? Only in divorce. The man has the right to divorce his wife, direct, but the woman can only divorce her husband through a judge. And this is the step, that's all. Even a woman can include in the marriage contract that I have the right to divorce you. Yes, she can do that. It's called al-isma, biyadiha. If the isma in her hand, if she says that in the marriage contract when they are registering the marriage and she says, I want to have the right to divorce him, yes. And he agrees, yes. We have no clue, as I was mentioning last Friday. So, Islam respects the opinion of women, as I said, and you have to consult them. Islam gave mothers a higher status than fathers. We all know the hadith. Ummak thumma ummak thumma ummak thumma abuk. Paradise is beneath the feet of the mother, not beneath your feet. Islam protects the reputation and the honor of chaste women against slander. If I slander a chaste woman and I cannot produce four eyewitnesses seeing the act of fornication, can you please move forward, please, everybody? What will be my punishment under Islamic law? Who can tell me?
No testimony is allowed.
Huh?
No witness will be.
No, the first one is what?
80.
In public.
Yes.
And then secondly, I will never be invited to give testimony. Yes? But if I repent, the following verse, if I repent, verse 5, chapter 24, if I repent and adjust my conduct, then Allah will forgive me. Beautiful. Every time there's a punishment in the Quran, it is followed by forgiveness, which is so beautiful. So beautiful. It is the responsibility of men to support women. And you are not doing your wife a favor by supporting her. It is her right. And this is so beautiful. الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم. It is the responsibility of the husband to support the wife fully, fully. Even if she's working and earning, the money goes into her pocket. It is his responsibility within his means to support her, to provide shelter over her head, to clothe her and to feed her. These are rights defined by the Quran and by the Prophet ﷺ. But we have so many problems because some women been denied this right. And that's why we have a lot of divorces because of this. So no husband is doing his wife any favor. Don't think you are doing your wife a favor by supporting. You know, this is her right. Some women feel very, very embarrassed. I was giving a talk to a group of English people, and mainly women. And one woman said to me, I feel very embarrassed to ask my husband to buy me a new dress. You see, this is culture. And I said to her, in Islam, if you are a Muslim woman, you have the right. It is your right. And not only that, there is something else very interesting. If you as a man, you go to Harrods and you buy your suit from there and you go to Oxfam to buy your wife a dress, it's unacceptable in Islam. The Quran says, وَمَتَّعُهُنَّ عَلَى الْمُوسِعِ قَدْرُ وَعَلَى الْمُقْتِرِ قَدْرُ مَتَاعًا بِالْمَعْرُوفِ حَقًّا عَلَى الْمُحْسِنِ. Spoil them. Quran says that. مُتْعَ here, مَتَاعًا. Spoil them. In accordance your means, or with accordance, or in accordance your means. If you are a well-off person, it's not the same when you are not a well-off person. But it is the right of the women to be spoiled by the husband. Now let me mention now the one of the most important rights in the next 5 minutes. We are expecting visitors actually today to come to visit us from immigration today. I'm looking for them. Anyway, they may come later. The right to live with dignity in a safe, non-hostile environment. At the time of Jahiliyyah, time of ignorance, newly born girls were buried alive. Oh my goodness. A woman is about to deliver a baby. They are sitting, someone is sitting there, and they already dig a hole in the sand. Ready. If it is a girl, straight in the sand, backfill, goodbye. And inshallah, next week maybe, I'll tell you a hadith which made the Prophet cry. He wept when he heard the story from a man. How did he kill his daughter after she grown up? So painful, the story. The Prophet ﷺ said, if you were not a Muslim now, I would have dealt with you differently. And he cried from what he heard from that man. So the pagan Arabs used to claim that the angels are females and they are the daughters of Allah. And when one of them will have the news of having a female, a daughter, they become so upset. The Quran describes to us here how did they... let me read it in Arabic first, very quick, very quick. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وإذا بشر أحدهم بالأنثى ظل وجهه مسودا وهو قضيب يتوارى من القوم من سوء ما بشر به أيمسكه على هون أم يدسه في التراب ألا ساء ما يحكمون. When news is brought to one of them of the birth of a female child, his face darkens and he is filled with inward grief. With shame, does he hide himself from his people because of the bad news he has had? Shall he retain it on surface and contempt or bury it in the dust? Ah, what an evil choice they decide on. It was an evil choice to decide on. Either alternative to keep the poor girl as a thing of sufferance and contempt, bringing disgrace on the family, or to get rid of it by burying it alive, was cruel and indefensible. Unfortunately, and on the day of judgment, in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. On the day of judgment, all these little girls who've been buried alive will be questioned by Allah. What sin did you commit to justify you being killed in this way? And my dear brothers and sisters, my dear children, this continues to happen today in our communities and in some parts of the world. When a woman go for a scan and they can see a baby girl, they go and abort. What's the difference between aborting and burying the girl alive?
Same.
There's no much difference. And I'm aware of men who unfortunately threaten their wives by saying, if you continue to give me girls, I'm going to divorce you. This is a true story. Someone in Egypt told me a woman had 9 daughters, 9 girls. And the husband said to her, if you give me another one, you are out. But this idiot, this stupid man, doesn't know that it is his sperm. You know how does it work? X and Y. We have X and Y. Women have XX. We have X and Y. So if the Y sperm doesn't get there before the X, she will have a daughter. It's nothing to do with the poor woman. The Prophet ﷺ explained this to us 1400 years ago when the chief rabbi in Medina came and questioned the Prophet ﷺ. And he said to him, I'm going to ask you a few questions. If you know the answer, I'll believe in you. And one of the questions was this: what determines the sex of the baby? And the Prophet ﷺ said, if the water of the man gets there first or the water of the woman, and he meant the X or the Y. So if your Y sperm is lazy, don't blame your wife. And again, it's up to Allah to decide. You are objecting to a gift from Allah. يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ الذُّكُورَ أَوْ يُزَوِّجُهُمْ ذُكْرَانًا وَإِنَاثًا وَيَجْعَلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ عَقِيمًا. It's up to him. It is him only who decides. And Islam means to submit your will to the will of God. If you don't accept it, you become a kafir. Immediately. Immediately you become a kafir. Immediately. If you look at a gift from Allah, a boy or a girl, you know, on the underground now they have an advert, very interesting advert. Pregnant woman, big tummy, and a question. A healthy boy or a girl? And then it says, the right word is healthy. So it doesn't matter, boy or a girl. It's Allah who decides. Like the case of Maryam, when the mother delivered the girl and said, إِنِّي وَضَعْتُهَا أُنْثَى وَلَا يَسَدَّقَرُكَ الْأُنْثَى وَإِنِّي سَمَّيْتُهَا مَرْيَمَ. Because at that time, the temple will only accept a boy to serve in the temple. And she wanted the child to serve in the temple. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy for Maryam to be in the temple. So say thank you to Allah. Whatever you get, say thank you to Him. In chapter 17, verse 31, we are told that poverty can lead some people to kill their own children, especially the girls, because the girl is not going to work, and the girl is not going to be breadwinner. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do not kill your children for fear of want. We shall provide sustenance for them as well as for you. Verily, the killing of them is a great sin. Unfortunately, can you imagine? People kill the children because they are going to share the food with them. Prophet ﷺ regarded this as a major sin. If you kill your child because he's going to share your food or you can't provide for him. Especially when you talk about girls here. Muslim women in some countries suffer from civil wad. We talked about the wad. I want you to learn Arabic, please, to learn at least some of these words. Wad means to bury someone alive. There's another form of wad in some Muslim countries called civil wad, when you deprive the women from their civil rights. Very bad. Very bad. Sometimes they apply Islamic law without understanding it. For example, according to the tradition, a woman shouldn't travel without a mahram. Does this mean today if my wife would like to travel to attend a conference in Birmingham, I have to go with her?
No.
Or if she's going to drive through the desert on a camel and there are pirates and there are bandits, then she needs the protection. So we need to understand the spirit of the hadith, why the hadith was said. we need to educate ourselves. Does this hadith apply to us today?
That circumstance is not there.
Exactly. If you have a similar circumstance, then we should. So, are women allowed to drive? Is it haram?
No.
For a woman to drive the car? Is it an obligation that women, when they go out, they should cover their faces, all of them? It depends where you are. It depends. If I live in a community where every man gazes at the face of my wife, I'll ask her to cover it. But it has nothing to do with Islam. Are we allowed today to deprive women from going to work, to take part in decent work as a teacher, as an accountant, as a lawyer, as a doctor, as a nurse? 50% of the population, there are more than 50% of the population today. Prophet ﷺ said, whoever has a daughter and did not kill her, and did not insult her, and did not favor his son over her, God will reward him with paradise, Abu Dawood. In another hadith he said, if you have one or more daughters and you bring them up righteously, they will act like a shield to protect you from the fire. I'm going to stop here now, okay? And we carry on next week, inshallah. Thank you.